and welcome to another episode of The Ranger Room. I'm Cade Kennedy, and it's not Andrew Santangelo with me this evening. It's Connor Gray once again with me. Connor, it's been a weekend. After we go off for Thanksgiving, I'm thinking, all right, this is going to be a normal weekend, you know, where the games are going to go how we think they are.
I don't know about all of you, but I had a great time.
I am not having a good time. I will say right now, I am straight up not having a good time. This is going to be a very interesting weekend, and why is that? Well, not only does Oklahoma State win Bedlam, putting Oklahoma State in the driver's seat to win the Big 12 and possibly be a win away from the college football playoff, but I've learned, and a lot of the nation has learned over the past few hours, really, I guess, Lincoln Riley, no longer the head coach at Oklahoma. He took the job at USC. Alex Grinch followed him, which was not really surprising to me. But we're just learning a lot of what was going on behind the scenes at Oklahoma. This is not a team that was functioning at all. This team was dysfunctional ever since the bye week.
That really affects a lot. I mean, probably could explain why they didn't come out and play well against Baylor in some aspect, even though that's still no excuse for the offensive side of the ball, because defense did their job most of the game. Then they got a solid win over a good Iowa State team at home, even though there were still struggles on the offense. It looked like they actually got it together for Bedlam for offensively. That first half was basically vintage Bedlam, what we've seen the last decade. High score, like scoring right out the gate, both teams going at it, and all. Then the second half became a different story.
Not to interrupt you here, but we're getting some kind of breaking stuff as it's coming in. Pete Sampson of The Athletic reporting a different coaching search, LSU, one that we'll get to in a moment, targeting Brian Kelly as their guy. LSU is a thing that they're trying to conjure up.
Okay. First of all,
I guess they saw USC can do it. Why not us?
Here's the thing. Brian Kelly's been at Notre Dame since like 2011, 2010.
He's been there for a decade.
He's been there over a decade. He's probably been offered so many opportunities to go to other other well-known brands that's not Notre Dame. He hasn't left over anything else. I don't see Brian Kelly probably leaving unless they literally give him so much money that he can't resist.
Which
the issue is Notre Dame can just counter that just as easily.
I mean, that's something that we thought was going to happen with LSU and Oklahoma, to kind of further get into what has been going on here in Norman.
Yep.
So this all starts really Thanksgiving Day, maybe the day before, where we hear all these crazy reports going on of Lincoln Riley's being offered allegedly $12 to $13 million a year to come coach at LSU. This whole situation going on here, how's it going to play into Bedlam? And most OU fans that I knew, including me, just blew it off. We thought, okay, this is just smoke coming out of the LSU camp. There's no credible evidence that this was going to happen. And then we get to Bedlam itself, Oklahoma State getting the win there. And right after the game, Lincoln Riley in his press conference, point blank, I'm not going to be the head coach of LSU. Next question. And so he was technically correct,
but he was also – he just did not want to really answer.
Yeah, the way he phrased that, it sounded like, okay, it's done. He's staying. Hooray for us, is in my perspective as an Oklahoma fan. But as it goes on, in the Sunday morning, Bruce Feldman reports that Iowa State's head coach Matt Campbell and Lincoln Riley of Oklahoma were going to get offered the job by USC. Matt Campbell turned the job down. But Lincoln Riley was intrigued by the offer that I'm learning, from what I heard last night, might be close to $15 million a year for 10 years.
That's really an offer you can't refuse.
I've heard, where was it? I had a source up here where someone was trying to specify exactly what they thought it was. See if I can find it here. I've been scrolling through way too much stuff today. I mean, this is the entire meltdown, not really meltdown, but what you'd expect after news like that. I think at one point I saw USC was going to buy up Lincoln's house in Norman, essentially giving him a $1 million bonus. They were going to give him use to a private jet for his family to use at any time.
Ooh.
USC pulling out really all the stops in this one. This is just allegedly. I don't know if that's confirmed or not.
All I know is pretty much that he's basically financially secured pretty much everything.
Yeah, he's set for life at this point, which, I mean, he was already getting $6-7 million from Oklahoma.
It's still that, even though it's a lot, it's like, oh, you cannot count. There's no way they could counter that.
There was no way they can counter that. But at
even
the same
then,
time,
it's just like,
it's one of those, to me at least, what are we doing here? Just what are we doing?
Because this led to a huge trickle effect, is that basically OU's recruiting classes for the next couple of years that were going to be right up, that obviously were top 10, maybe top 5, are now drastically dropping to the point where they're going outside the top 20, possibly top 30.
Yeah, this really takes a hammer to the recruiting classes of 2022.
You just lost a 5-star quarterback that was going to be in the 23 class, and you lost a receiver, a linebacker, and a running back, all 4-stars, respectively. So it's like, okay, who else is dropping from that class? Because now these guys are going to go look at other big universities. That
a
are
lot
not,
of them
or some of them are going
to
commit
to follow
or,
Lincoln Riley.
That's, or I was about to say, or they're going to follow USC because that's where he's going.
Yeah, and it's disappointing to me, and that was kind of the sentiment expressed in the press conference today Oklahoma had just an hour and a half ago. It wasn't really much they knew about it either. They found out only a few minutes before the rest of us found out. This completely came out of nowhere and was really a slap in the face to everyone here. There was just zero expectation this would ever happen. No one expected this. And all I can say is I'm incredibly disappointed.
In regards to, like, any coaches, he's not the first to do something like this, and he won't be the last, but it's still something that – issue is that it was just – he can't really announce that before Bedlam, but it's also just really dumb to announce it directly after.
Well, I think it's kind of interesting to your point of this will happen again and has happened before. It's kind of interesting for Oklahoma because this really hasn't happened. Oklahoma's a rare exception to that.
Yeah, OU's the rare exception because the last time a coach left for another job in the, like, whether they're on top or whatever, wasn't back in 1947.
Yes, when Jim Tatum left to go to Maryland. That the guy after that, some offensive coordinator named Bud Wilkinson.
So
and then the other time.
Otherwise, this has never happened to OU. They're one of the few universities where this has ever happened, where a coach will just up and leave out of nowhere.
For another college. Usually it's a retirement, or OU just straight up fires them, as we saw several times in the 90s.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just intriguing to me, really, the past 24 hours at the really 27, I guess, if we want to be specific here.
Yeah.
Of just the rumor mill going from Oklahoma is going to be the next Nebraska and is never going to be good again to what I've seen in the past hour and a half. The flight trackers are out, everybody. It's that type of the season, which I did not expect to be getting into thinking, okay, Big 12 championship's coming up. I did not expect to be here at this point.
Well, and the thing is for Oklahoma State and Baylor, their game's going to be sidelined until probably Friday or Saturday, because the news will just be dominated of the Lincoln Riley and the coaching carousel.
Yeah, I mean, to me, that's the interesting thing, that Oklahoma State wins Bedlam for the first time in 7 years, and the main story coming out of it is Lincoln Riley's no longer the head coach of Oklahoma.
OSU tore his heart out so badly that they forced him to go to USC.
Well, I mean, Gundy put that cowboy hat on. That's just game over after that. The Joe Exotic, I cannot financially recover from this meme, is basically what happened there. But Bob Stoops is the interim head coach of Oklahoma now.
From what we can tell so far, he has no plans to even come back. Obviously, OU's going to be looking for
this. This is just a one-time thing.
Yeah, this is just a one-time thing because he's enjoying his Fox analyst job.
Yeah, then
he has no desire to come back.
Yeah,
to coaching.
He will be able to do both. He will be at the Big Ten championship game with Big Noon mm-hmm. kickoff, and then
he'll go do whatever he needs to
do. Yeah, go back to whatever Oklahoma needs to do. But the main target today, the flavor of the day, I guess, if you will, is none other than Brent Venables. Clemson defensive coordinator, used to be the defensive coordinator at Oklahoma in the early 2010s, late 2000s.
Yeah, with Mike Stoops.
With Mike Stoops. And so this is going to be very interesting. I don't know if you've seen any of the stuff going on today online. Maybe, maybe not. But it has been kind of funny because I feel like this is usually the point where I look at other programs and see their insane coaching searches and go, haha, this is funny. I hope this never happens to us. And now I'm living it. So I'm going to say this, and this is going to sound crazy, and this probably won't mean anything ever, but it's fun to speculate. So there was apparently a story today on Snapchat of both of Venables' sons in a car with DJ Uiagalelei, the quarterback of Clemson, and they were all doing the horns down in the car saying Boomer Sooner. Now, I don't think that has anything to do with anything at all, but a lot of OU fans for about 30 minutes had extreme hope that we were going to do to Clemson what USC just did to Oklahoma. It was the most insane 30 minutes of my life I've seen on the internet, where OU fans went from the ultimate low to the ultimate high. A bunch of former OU players have come out and said, we need Coach Venables back to be the guy at OU. He can write this. If anyone can do it, it can be him. So I'm curious to see where you stand on this, because I have my own opinions and stuff going on. But
the thing is like, in regards to like his, because he's currently the defense coordinator at Clemson, I believe, right?
Yes.
That's an interesting, but it's whether he want. Obviously, it'll come down to what if he wants to do it. I mean, can give it a shot, though he has yet to really prove. He needs to prove himself as a head coach. But you're bringing a guy who's just been a coordinator most of his career to where it's like, okay, is he even actually capable of being able to do it? Because obviously, yeah, you have a defensive coordinator that has a more defensive mind, but you run into a problem where it's like, does he actually really, can he actually do it? That's always what it comes down to. Especially people have the same thing with Riley, but thing is, you still, with Riley, he's like, he already was able to, like, you know, soon he'll just step right in and nothing will really change.
And speaking of Lincoln Riley, stage is getting set currently at the Coliseum for his press conference. They're getting everything ready to go out there for his big reveal. Alex Grinch set to be with him, Oklahoma's wide receiver coach. Simmons is going to be there as well as Wiley, the strength and conditioning coach. And even OU's director of football operations made the trip over. He's going to be a new member of the coaching staff, I guess. They all left this morning on the plane out of Will Rogers. So,
oh, boy.
So, a lot of people gone. Apparently, this is all continuing to be speculation, that when Lincoln Riley met with the team yesterday, after most of them had found out on social media already, it was a quick little 2 to 3 minute deal, and then he left. And the rumor swirling around is that DeMarco Murray called him out to his face. DeMarco Murray being the running back coach for Oklahoma, and said, you know, spare me your crocodile tears. You wanted to get out of here. Don't try to act like you're sad to leave. And so this just kind of exemplifies, I think, what has been going on here at Oklahoma.
Well, it also just doesn't help that you come off losing. You pretty much, you lost your shot at the playoff. Everyone's jaded, especially OU fans are very jaded. And then, obviously, this news comes out, so it makes things even worse. I mean, just kind of watching Skip Bayless, just kind of him ranting was just like, he was like, I'm done with Riley already. It's like, you were on the Riley train, and then this happened, then all of a sudden you're just done with him.
Well, to be fair, I think that is how a lot of OU fans felt this year.
But he then tried to complain about defense being bad. I'm like, did you forget about Mike Stoops?
And then real quick here, Matt Zenitz of On3 Sports, Washington expected to hire Kalen DeBoer of Fresno State as their next head coach.
That's a good hire for Washington. It's a good hire. But
so things continue to get wacky here in college football, and the kind of interesting thing to me is we haven't even gotten to anything yet.
We have not recapped anything.
This may be one of those we spend a long time here
that'll probably be our thing we'll probably talk about tomorrow.
Yeah, this is kind of – today is more of a
– just kind of
– recapping the madness of Sunday and Monday here now as things continue. Brent Venables, there was a flight tracker from Charleston, South Carolina to Oklahoma City that landed an hour and a half ago at this point. People were trying to speculate if that meant anything. Dusty Dvorak came out and said before the press conference, guys, they're not going to announce Venables as the head coach. They haven't. They've just now started looking. They're not going to announce anything today.
Yeah.
Why would they do that? There's no way OU was going to make a hire in 20 hours.
No.
That would be impossible almost.
You got, they're gonna, what they're going to do is they're pretty much just take the next few weeks to figure out who they want as their next head coach.
But, I mean, the other thing here, Spencer Rattler, of course, transferring away from Oklahoma.
That's not surprising.
Caleb Williams put out a statement where he didn't really say he was staying, but didn't say he was leaving either. No one knows.
I'm not going to be surprised if Caleb, like, I wouldn't be surprised if he stayed, but I wouldn't be surprised if he left to go to USC.
It wouldn't surprise me.
So if that happens, OU does not have a star quarterback. As much as people ragged on Rattler for his thing, Rattler is still a solid quarterback. I mean, he needs to get into another system.
He does.
That could really fit him. Just the way Riley was doing things this season was not working.
Yeah,
So that's where Caleb, I think, works in better. So if Caleb leaves to go to USC, which there's actually a better opening job because the USC quarterbacks have not been good at all this year. So he could probably easily get the starting job, and plus Riley knows how to work with him.
Yeah, this is one of those things that just continues to get more and more insane as it topples over itself. I really don't know.
Well, but let's probably just go ahead and save the rest of this for tomorrow because I won't be able to be here much longer.
All right, well, let's just kind of get through the NFL real quick, kind of talk about it, as kind of just fly through some of these. Getting through the Thanksgiving Day games real quick. Chicago, Detroit, Bears get a 16-14 win. Mm-hmm. Detroit calls two timeouts in a row and essentially gave the Bears a free first down.
Yeah, pretty
on
much.
Terrible defense. Bears get a win. Hooray for them. Vegas beats the Cowboys 36-33.
That was one heck of a game.
Probably the game of the day.
But so many penalties.
There were a lot of penalties in that.
But it was a really good football game.
And also, sure enough, I believe Dak Prescott got COVID today. I believe if that was.
No, that was Mike McCarthy.
McCarthy. Okay. One of the two. I remember seeing
that.
And I couldn't remember
Dan
which
Quinn
one
will be taking over as the coach for the Saints game.
All righty. So Dan Quinn, yeah, will be the coach for the Cowboys there. And then Buffalo gets a 31-6 win over the Saints. Bills suddenly look like what we all thought they looked like.
Well, the problem is, can they stay that way? Can they be consistent?
No, they can't.
Exactly.
That's not allowed. Speaking of inconsistent, Cincinnati 41-10 over Pittsburgh. Steelers play absolutely terrible. Bengals bringing the heat on that one.
Roethlisberger looked like Mason Rudolph against Detroit.
Yeah, it was an interesting game there. And then Tampa Bay with the comeback, beating Indianapolis. Colts forgot they had Jonathan Taylor, I guess.
And one
really
thing,
the only explanation, like, I have for that game.
Yeah, it's like one thing I saw a headline like from ESPN, like, are the Bucs better when Brady isn't having to carry the team? Like, no, like, that team is so full of talent, like, Brady shouldn't have to carry the team. Brady's 44 years old. He shouldn't have to be carrying everybody. Instead, it's like these last, almost the entire season so far, it's been Brady carrying the load. The whole team actually starts playing well, they actually can be one of the best teams in the NFL. Instead, they just, nah.
That's not allowed.
Not to do it.
Miami, I said, look out. Miami's schedule gets favorable. Here they are, 33-10 win over the Panthers. I don't know what's going on in Carolina anymore. I don't know if they just kind of quit as a team not really quit, but they're just not playing well at the moment. Dolphins look good for a change.
Mm-hmm.
Tennessee goes into New England with a bunch of backups and gets absolutely smashed in the fourth quarter. Patriots getting a 36-13 win there. Mm-hmm. Then moving on here, Philadelphia takes a trip to MetLife, and they got beat 13-7 in a game where Jalen Hurts had a major turnover problem. Just absolutely could not hold on to the ball. I think at one point he had three or four interceptions.
Yeah.
It's not a fun time.
No, it wasn't.
Atlanta taking a trip to Jacksonville, getting a win 21-14. They get one over Jacksonville. They did not fall the same fate as Buffalo. And then the Jets take a trip down to Houston, beat the Texans.
That was one of the worst games I ever saw.
That was one of the best games I've ever seen.
It was so, like, both teams did not play good.
No. But speaking of teams rising up that I kind of thought maybe had a shot, but not really. Denver, 28-13, they beat the Chargers.
Good on them.
Broncos defense holding strong.
Chargers being inconsistent as usual.
Why do you need offense when you can simply get a pick six? Why would you ever do that? And then one of the games of the week, really, Green Bay 36 and the Rams 28. This is a fun one
to
watch.
That was a good game to watch. Well, both came out playing really well. Rodgers doing his thing and Stafford and company doing theirs.
Then another one here. Minnesota going into San Fran and not being able to pull it off. Niners getting a 34-26 win. How about the Niners?
They're starting winning again.
They're getting there. And then Sunday night game, Cleveland defense stepped up. Problem. Offense is now a problem. Cleveland is kind of in that weird situation where they can either have a good offense and no defense or a good defense and no offense.
I think it's getting to the point where Baker's arm is just his injuries are nagging him.
Yeah, I mean, good on the Browns defense. You made Lamar throw 4 interceptions. Still wasn't enough.
Nope.
If you had all I asked for, 3 good drives a game, and we got 2. But we did not get 3. And then Monday night tonight, Seattle taking a trip to Washington to play the football team. Just real quick pick here on this one.
I'm Washington.
Yeah, I think I'll go with Washington as well. Now moving on real quick to college football, because I know you got to skedaddle here quickly today.
We'll save the bigger games because we'll actually talk about them.
Yeah, we can kind of run through scores here, and then we'll be back. Andrew Santangelo will be with us hopefully tomorrow. As we get ready to break down even further, coach watch at OU and all sorts of other crazy things. Starting here Thursday night, Egg Bowl. Ole Miss gets a 31-21 win. Lane Kiffin getting Ole Miss to 10 regular season wins. Never been done before in Ole Miss. Never had 10 wins in the regular season. So big win there for the Rebels. Moving on here, Cincinnati going out to Greenville, beating up East Carolina 35-13.
From what I can tell from most of that game, Cincinnati didn't really beat them up until like halfway through the second.
This was one of those games that I watched way too much of where Cincinnati, when they decided to play, they started destroying.
Oh, yeah.
They would turn it off and then turn it on. They were off and on the entire game.
Yeah, but they pretty much handled Eastern Carolina no problem.
Nebraska, new quarterback, no problem for 3 quarters. Cursed special teams.
And then nuclear disaster.
The curse of Nebraska special teams strikes again. A blocked punt and then a safety. And then Iowa kicks another field goal to go up and tie the game. And then they take the lead at the end. And Nebraska throws an interception on a big miscommunication.
Nebraska set history where they lost 9 games within single digits.
Yeah, they had 9 games and they had a perfect total of a net margin of 0.
That's truly
proving Nebraska is the greatest 3-9 team of all time. Argument settled.
Pretty much.
Truly an honor watching them this year. How did Scott Frost keep his job?
I don't know.
They're this close. But so far.
Mm-hmm.
And then next one's up here. Utah getting a 28-13 win on Colorado. Utes got up 14-0 and then just kind of went back to sleep. But they didn't really need to do a whole lot.
Yeah, you didn't need to do it. Yeah, it's Colorado. You don't really need to do much.
And then NC State getting a comeback for the ages for them.
34-30
beating North Carolina.
When I was down in Stillwater with family during that game, we met up with some of their friends. I was watching that game. I went, oh my! Like some of us in the bar when we were at the Iron Monk bar, we were just like, oh my goodness. Really can't believe what just happened.
That San Diego State getting a 27-16 win over Boise State. Solid win there for the Aztecs.
Mm-hmm.
Arkansas just rips through Missouri 34-17.
Mm-hmm.
We got to talk about this one just for the fun of it.
Yeah.
Texas beats K-State 22-17. So, to clarify, once again for everybody, teams from Kansas went 1-1 in Austin this year, and it was the Jayhawks getting a win.
Not Kansas State, but the Jayhawks.
Texas went 5-7. That is still not good enough for a bowl game.
No.
As
the only way
there were 83 bowl-eligible teams this year out of the 82 slots.
Mm-hmm.
So that's not happening.
That's not happening. So tough luck, Texas. Don't even try next year.
I mean, they'll try.
I don't want them to
They'll be back.
No, they won't.
For about 1 weekend. Maybe. We don't know. Or maybe we do.
I don't know.
What I can't tell you, Georgia's Georgia at this point. 45-0 over Georgia Tech.
They quietly beat up Georgia Tech.
This is a game no one watched because there was a certain other game going on that had the eyes of the nation.
Exactly.
Estimated so far, maybe up to 15 million people watched this game, the most watched game of the year. Michigan did it. Michigan 42, Ohio State 27, and it wasn't even that close.
No, it really wasn't. Michigan just ran all over Ohio State, just flat out beat them up on the ground.
Michigan had a mission today. Jim Harbaugh said this year he was going to beat Ohio or die trying, and by goodness, they did it. Michigan, I mean, not to get too much into this, I'll save more of my comments for tomorrow's show, but just watching that first two drive, that first full drive for them on offense and defense, they were ready for blood.
They smelled blood in the water.
Yeah, and usually you can get that in like the third quarter or fourth quarter. Right from the get-go, it felt like Ohio State had this weird, they kind of didn't want to be there attitude that I kind of picked up on.
It felt like that, but the way both teams were reacting to each other before halftime, they were at each other's throats. Like
they were.
There were like they showed camera footage in the tunnel because obviously there's the one tunnel because the stadium was built for only one entrance.
Yes.
So
gotta love old
when
stadiums.
Those two teams constantly met up going into halftime, it literally took probably about 5-8 minutes just to get them in the locker rooms because they were going at each other's throats.
Yeah. And then moving on to another great game. Alabama survives in four overtime.
They should have lost that game.
Bama defeats Auburn 24-22.
The trifecta didn't happen.
Bryce Young gets his Heisman moment, if you want to say one, where he's able to just march right down the field and get Alabama back.
It's a Heisman moment, but good Lord.
It's a Heisman moment on a top of a not a really good Heisman game.
No, like Alabama, that was the worst I've ever against a Power 5 team they've ever played. That we've seen. Like, they lost to A&M. They lost to A&M, but the game overall was a better product. This game was just bad throughout.
I don't know about you, but I love 3-0 games.
I mean, it was
I love it when it's terrible offense against terrible offense, and that's not something you think of when you think of the Iron Bowl.
Exactly.
You're not thinking, okay, this is going to be a 3-0 game. But one game that was an absolute blowout. Notre Dame just takes care of business, 45-14 over Stanford. Stanford got that one win over Oregon and then bolted. Their season was done after that game.
Yep,
they did
much.
Their job and got out. Then Oklahoma taking a trip to Stillwater. Oklahoma State getting the job done, 37-33, puts the Pokes in shot for the Big 12 title game. And the other team, Baylor, surviving 27-24. Texas Tech missing a field goal in the end of regulation. Bears get a 27-24 win.
And therefore – making sure OU does not get in the title game because even if OU lost, if Baylor would have lost, they would have been in.
Yeah, then we would have got a rematch. And then this would have gotten even more insane because Lincoln Riley would have had to stay another week to be the head coach for that. Mm-hmm. And then you're talking about if he bolts right before the playoff game.
Exactly.
What a scenario that would have been. That would have upset the OU fan base even further. But next game up here, Oregon went in the Civil War. They get that platypus trophy, 38-29. They knock down the Beavers. Michigan State having fun in the snow on senior day. What fun to have in the snow. Whiteout conditions in East Lansing, it felt like.
Yep.
Michigan State 30-27. The late night game, the last game of the regular season to involve a ranked team, and it's BYU beating USC 35-31 in a late night thriller. And Minnesota sends Iowa to the Big Ten
They
title
got
game.
The Paul Bunyan's axe
the
now.
The axe is back in Minneapolis. Minnesota getting a 23-13 win.
I mean,
Morgan, huge win for him. And he announces he will be coming back for his sixth season with the Gophers.
All right, then. So you have some veterans coming back. I mean, with Minnesota, it's like, for regardless, yes, their season's not the way they wanted it. Like, obviously, for anything. And obviously, even if they win. Winning this game, they don't go to the Big Ten title game, but they at least prevent their rival from going.
Yeah, and you know the funny part is we were one Nebraska meltdown away from it happening. Everything that needed to go Minnesota's way almost happened.
Yep.
They're just one Nebraska meltdown away.
Mm-hmm.
But that happened, that could be said about a lot of things.
Yeah, exactly.
And final games here, we talked about it, Tanner Morgan not having his final game, but Coach O, in his final game in Death Valley, stuns Texas A&M right at the end, 27-24.
Took out the Pretenders.
One final go Tigers for Coach O, and now he gets to go live his best life.
And some people were, there was like some people on social media, like they fired this man, like they, because of how he was after the game, especially with just how much he really loved being at LSU. It was like they fired this guy. I'm like, well, it kind of happens when you don't really do well. Especially, yeah. I understand he won a national title, but that was 2 years ago. 2020 didn't go so well, and then 2021 was even worse, in my opinion.
And then Pittsburgh, number 17 in the country, they're already celebrating. They were going to get to go play in the ACC title game. They cap it off with a 31-14 win over Syracuse. And their opponent, Wake Forest, they get a 41-10 win over Boston College. And we get Pitt and Wake for the ACC title.
We get a shootout.
As we all predicted at the beginning of the year.
We totally predicted.
Totally predicted.
Let's be real. In regards to, besides probably Georgia and Alabama, and probably you could say Oregon and Utah, who predicted these other matchups?
No one.
No one, because everyone was thinking.
It's a crazy year.
Because OU and Iowa State is supposed to probably go back to the Big 12 title game. OSU and Baylor were not even predicted.
Baylor was eighth in the preseason polls in the Big 12.
Yeah, and also each of them had a 3% or lower to even get to the title game where they're at. The fact that Baylor had a huge turnaround from 2020 and Oklahoma State just doing their thing and winning games. It's like, and now they're both in the title game. And then you have the Big Ten. It was predicted, well, maybe it's going to probably be the Big Ten West was weird because it was either Wisconsin or Iowa.
Yeah,
everyone was like, oh, it's going to be Ohio State. Now Ohio State's gone. You have Michigan, who's in the title game for the first time. And then you have Iowa.
Yeah,
I don't know why I'm blanking on
Michigan,
no,
Iowa.
Michigan, Iowa, going to probably be, feels like it's going to be another Big Ten solid matchup for that. And then you it's been a crazy season. And then obviously ACC, you have Pittsburgh and Wake Forest. No one saw Wake coming. Even though, yes, Wake's not like the most amazing team, the fact that they even made it to their title game is astonishing because you don't look, when it comes to ACC football, you're just looking at Clemson or Florida State's history. You're
and
not really
Miami.
And sometimes Miami, but otherwise you're just not paying attention to them.
Yeah.
You're just like, wait, you guys can actually play football?
And then, speaking of teams no one cared about, UTSA, their journey comes to an end in Denton. 45-23, North Texas blows out the Roadrunners.
Looks like,
and there are two undefeateds left in college football.
They couldn't meet their way to victory.
They cannot meet their way to a 12-0 season.
So now all the undefeateds are is Georgia and Cincy. And now now it's up to wonder, does Cincy keep it up in their title game and Georgia take care of business against Alabama? Though it's as much as people are easily predicting Georgia to win. Don't count Alabama out.
You can't count Alabama
out. No matter how bad they've been playing most of the year in regards with certain games, they're still Alabama. It's Nick Saban. You cannot bet against them a lot of time. No matter how dominant Georgia has been against everybody they played, like, you cannot count them out because Alabama can be sneaky and take one. And when the SEC game, therefore solidifying themselves as number one and putting Georgia probably at number four or three,
yeah,
depending on where they put at.
And then next game here, an interesting one. Clemson gets a 30-0 just shut down of South Carolina.
That's not surprising.
In a game, here's the fun part, though. Neither team passed for over 100 yards.
That's odd.
This is a very weird game that not a lot of people saw unless you're a South Carolinian or you just like the Palmetto Bowl every year. But it was an odd game in that terms where neither team really could pass the ball, but Clemson was able to run the ball, and that's what you got to do to win these games.
Oh, and as of probably about less than an hour ago, ESPN kind of reported that Gary Bohannon, who's the first string quarterback for Baylor, they're not guaranteeing he'll actually play Saturday,
yeah,
because
so
his hamstring injury is still nagging him pretty good enough where it's going to affect his play.
Yeah, that'll be interesting
so
to see how that goes.
More likely, obviously, if you're OSU, prepare for both quarterbacks, but more likely be ready to prepare for, was it Shape?
Yeah, Shape.
Yeah, Shape. The second string for Baylor. So, obviously, that, you got to prepare for that. Though, obviously, Cowboys are going to be favored to win that game. Still, it's going to be a really solid one, but I know it's, but pretty much we'll get to that Tuesday. Or actually,
yeah.
No, we'll get to that Thursday.
Yeah, we'll get to that more on Thursday. But Houston, wrapping this up here, Houston does what everyone kind of expected them to do. They go blow out UConn 45-17,
mm-hmm.
setting up Cincy and Houston as what should be a top 25 matchup.
Should be.
And so it will be an interesting week of college football. We'll break more of that down on Thursday. But tomorrow, Andrew Santangelo joins us. We'll have a lot more to talk about. We'll continue the Oklahoma search for a head coach. That's going to be one of the dominant stories of this entire week here in college football. Talk about Big Ten title game, Big 12 title game, ACC title game, Pac-12 title game.
And
SEC is the king, though, with that giant matchup there. We'll have the college football ranking show coming out tomorrow at 6, so that will be intriguing to see.
And for tomorrow, we'll actually break down some of the bigger games.
Yeah.
Because we've been having a rush a bit of today, so we haven't been able to talk. We'll definitely talk Bedlam. We'll talk about the game, Michigan, Ohio State. Definitely break down a few other games that were really big this last weekend.
Yeah, we'll break down really everything that happened. You get to hear my fun officiating rant for about 15 minutes tomorrow, so that's going to be fun. We need to have a serious discussion about Kevin Hassel and this Big 12 crew, really just officiating in general, because it has been just bad this year as a whole.
Yeah, overall, that Bedlam game, they were bad.
That Bedlam game.
Both teams got away with a lot of stuff.
And Oklahoma State got away with a little bit more, I think. I am biased there.
He's very biased there.
But, you know,
I think it
I
even,
didn't know
I
you
think
could
it,
chokehold people.
I think it even itself out for the 12 times you guys jumped off sides and no calls.
And all of them were called, correct?
No, they weren't. Not all of them were called.
Most of them were called.
No, they were not. Only like four or five of them were called.
And those that were called.
And the ones that were, and then the 12, and there was like seven others that they did not call.
Yes, because
so it evens it out.
Off sides. He stayed in the neutral zone and OSU didn't snap it. This is just like the Iowa State game last year.
He was still in the neutral zone whenever he snapped the ball. But whatever.
Yeah, anyway, it doesn't
We'll have our shouting match tomorrow about
that.
Yeah,
well, we'll have fun with that tomorrow. But that is going to wrap it up for tonight. It has been an interesting day so far. It'll continue to be tomorrow. The search goes on. Life goes on. Oklahoma State and Baylor, it's just going to be an interesting Big 12 title game. It's weird for me to not be thinking about, okay, this is – time to win a conference title, but interesting as well to see some new faces in there. So for Connor Gray, I'm Cade Kennedy. Have a great night, everybody.